To find the source of the Ex, you must climb high into the Exmoor Hills, and this can be a cold experience in midwinter. So cold can conditions be up here, over 1,000 feet above sea level, that the frost clings to everything. Even wire fences take on a 3D aspect as the wind sculpts the ice. And it's through this frozen gateway that you must go to follow our river to its source. This tiny rivulet in the snow doesn't look much, but it's just about as close as you can get to a recognisable beginning to one of the West Country's greatest rivers. The River Ex emerges from a huge morass, a sort of high bogland known as the Chains. And Ex Plain is just part of this great sponge-like area of Exmoor, which lies northwest of Simmonsbath and south of the seaside communities of Linton and Lynmouth. If the Ex had managed to rise just a few hundred metres to the north, it would, like the River Lynn, have run just 6 miles down to the Bristol Channel and saved itself the 64-mile journey through Somerset and Devon to the south coast. It's odd to think that as the rest of southern Britain seems to become ever more crowded, this high corner of a much-loved national park has probably never been more unfrequented and lonely. It's even more ironic to think that once these snowy wastes were populated by mammoth, bison, bear, woolly rhinoceros and wild ox, not to mention a number of Stone Age men who enjoyed a much warmer climate than the one we know today. These Stone Age people were nomadic and moved about the moor with their small herds of sheep and goats. But some 4,000 years ago, a new race of people came onto the scene. And so started the Bronze Age proper. This is when man started to leave his permanent mark upon the landscape. As the climate deteriorated, so did the population of the uplands. And the Iron Age Celts, Romans and Saxons came and went without leaving too much of an impression on these lonely hilltops. The Royal Forest of Exmoor, which has the headwaters of the Ex running through its very heart, was established by the Normans, who were passionately fond of hunting. But it wasn't until the 17th century that the moors surrounding the river began to see agriculture on anything like a modern scale. A Dutchman called James Beevy began the serious business of farming here, but it was the Knight family who really developed the area as far as agriculture and mining were concerned. Having bought up most of the old forest, John Knight based his hilltop kingdom at Simmonsbath and proceeded to embark upon a great program of reclamation and mining. He and later his son Frederick achieved remarkable results, but in the end the extreme elements of the high moor were against them. Stan Curtis worked on what had once been the Knight's Exmoor estate, and in company with the National Park Warden Mike Leach, he recalls the tough life of the moor.
When did you actually last use horses for ploughing on the estate here?
Oh, it would have been early in the 50s, right. Yeah, because, I am actually ploughed on this estate since the 50s, but I used to plough for Farmer Thorne out the other end of the village, 46, 7 and 8 down. Only going back to when the 1948 blizzard was, us couldn't get out. Us was in there for weeks and weeks and weeks. Us used to walk to Exford cross country and get the provisions in, and right on this spot, yeah, us used to in the end, us had a helicopter come in there. Right. But since that, machinery have made everything that much easier. Us don't care how much snow us get now, because us just go up and get a loader and keep driving, and you can get through it now with all the modern gear that's about. Council comes out here sometimes. Us was up, clearing the snow on what is called Gallinose Plain between here and Exford, and I was working nights, and I was cleaning the same piece of road. Oh, it must have been for, I suppose, 2 months. And the other chap that was driving the bulldozer, he would work it the day, and then I would do the same piece again in the night, because keep blowing in, blocking the roads again. I think, suppose I can remember, it was 48, that was for about 13 weeks then, before any traffic come in, you know. We haven't been really cut off, because we've managed, well, a gang of us would get out and walk Exmoor and that, and get our provisions. Well, bang they days, you see, there wasn't no electric here, you hadn't got no deep freezes, so now you think you're so right, well, us will get someone in, get the deep freeze filled in, sort of in autumn, and then you're ready.
Down to salt in those days, I suppose.
That, well, it was all salt, yeah, put it in the salter, kill the pig, and salt it in. Well, there's a limitation to what you can do with that. Tell you what I picked up this morning, I don't know if you've ever seen one. What about Ina?
Yeah, look at that. Yeah.
Poor white mole.
Have you ever seen one before?
No, I never seen one before. Yeah, yeah, pretty rare that is. Got little hands on them, say.
Yeah.
But it's different weather here today.
Now we must begin our journey down the river and leave these wintry scenes behind. As the snow and ice melts, we pass the lonely Warren farm and follow the Ex along its course towards Exford. The occasional find of sheep bones supplies all the evidence one needs to recognise that life is really tough up here on the moors. And talking of being tough, the men who worked this mine 100 feet or so above the river must have been particularly hard. The fine stone arch only runs back for a distance of 30 feet or so, and from then on the walls are rough hewn to where the adit is now blocked off 115 feet into the hill. The Plymouth Iron Company raised 500 tons of ore from this dark, damp hole in 1858. The Honeymead Mine is situated just above a particularly dramatic part of the river known as Ex Cleve. The flooding problem, shared by all Exmoor mines, meant that the honeymead had no real industrial future, and so this beautiful wilderness area was saved, and the river has been left in peace to make its way to the first village on our journey. Exmoor is situated in the river valley at the very heart of the national park. It's an attractive place which plays host to a good deal of the area's equine activities and is especially important to lovers of the rare and splendid Exmoor pony. It's by the river that every year, in early May, the Exmoor Pony Society holds its all-important stallion parade. Within any breed, stallions have a profound influence, and it's here that the experts are able to view the young colts at close quarters. Rarer than the giant panda, the Exmoor pony is reckoned to be among the closest of any equine breed to the ancient wild horse that spread across the Earth's surface from their original Siberian home. And this parade plays an important part in keeping this rare semi-wild breed pure. Exford also hosts the annual Exmoor Pony Breed Show, where the many qualities of this remarkable animal are on display.
This is a final call for the highest placed Moorbred pony from classes 1 to 9. The highest placed pony bred away from the moor in classes 1 to 9. And the highest placed exhibitor bred pony in classes 1 to 9. Would you please come to the collecting ring now as your respective championships will be judged shortly. Thank you.
I've had a marvellous day judging today, Harold. I've recovered from the wet, and I think I got some super ponies from the classes here. What do you think of them?
I can agree more.
I think this mare here has got almost everything one's looking for in an Exmoor. In particular today, I wanted to get a pony that's strong enough. We've got plenty of room, a lot of room under the jaw here. All the better to eat with, as who was it, Red Riding Hood said. But I want a lot of space there, and I want a kind head. I want a broad one. I think this is a lovely head, don't you?
Beautiful head.
And the eye themselves here are so prominent.
Yes.
Which is one of the... Oops, it's
bold gone away, eye, isn't it?
Which is... That really is the toad eye. This very heavy colouring over the top here. And was one of the things we particularly liked. I particularly liked it judging.
And now we leave Exford to enjoy one of the most beautiful stretches of the Ex. This is an ideal stretch to watch the early morning river mists. From here to the next village of Winsford, the hills close in, and for the most part, the roar of the combustion engine is unheard in this remote corner. Thank you. Spring is a wonderful time to explore the banks of any Exmoor River. The area is well known for its profusion of snowdrops, which always greet the slight rises in temperature. Exmoor is in fact a treasure house of flora and fauna, as the National Park ecologist David Boyce explains.
I think it's the mixture of habitats that we've got here. We've got a fabulous coastline with wonderful coastal heath with gorse and heather. Then as you come inland up onto the moorland, you've got large areas of uplands with different kinds of moorland communities, with heather areas again, but also with grass-dominated, much more boggy moorland. And then as you come off the plateau tops down into the valleys, you've got these fabulous woodlands, such as the one we're in now, the Baal Valley, Horner, various other huge woodlands dominated by oak, beech, ash. I suppose one of the things that we're most important for is the lichens that you get in the woodlands, which are very, very scarce now in Britain and indeed in the rest of Europe. Old trees like this ash are tremendously important. They have an incredible variety of lichens associated with them. Now, when you look at a tree like this for the first time, many of those forms may not be immediately obvious. They do vary tremendously in their form. Big conspicuous species like this tree lungwort here, big foliose leafy varieties, but then right down to these very small inconspicuous white crusts on the bark, which you might not think much of at all, but they're all lichens, and on a tree such as this you might have as many as 20 or 30 different types. Different lichens occur in different habitats, and in the Baal Valley the species of particular importance are those that occur on the bark of trees. Having said that, there are other types of lichen that occur on rocks, on the soil, in a variety of other habitats, in fact. Lichens have been shown to be tremendously accurate in measuring different levels of atmospheric pollution, in as much as they've actually managed to draw a map up of the British Isles that has different zones from what are known as lichen deserts around the major industrial centres in Britain, like Birmingham, London and the North East. And then at the other end of the scale, areas like Scotland, Wales and the southwest of England, where we are now, where you have tremendous diversities of lichens.
And so to the next village on the Exe. Winsford, with its famous thatched pub and village green, is a popular place with visitors who all enjoy the babbling Wynn Brook as it passes through the village to join the larger river. One of the nation's great trade union leaders and politicians was born here to a poor widow woman who already had eight other mouths to feed. Born in March 1881, Ernest Bevan eventually left his humble origins and went on to become one of the great foreign secretaries of the day. The parish church of St. Mary Magdalene stands guard over this seemingly timeless community, and the Exe meanders east away from the village before deciding upon its final direction and turning south to start its journey to the distant English Channel. Its first visit on the journey south is to the hamlet of Bridgetown, named after this elegant single-arched bridge. Nearby, trout cruise the slightly stiller water created by the weir which once provided water for one of Exmoor's biggest watermills. Now the Ex wriggles and rides its way to its next important appointment, its confluence with the River Barl. The Barl is a truly impressive contributory, so impressive that one could question why it didn't win the name game and become ascendant over the Ex. If that had been so, we'd have Barlator, Barlman, on our Devonshire maps. Anyway, the name Ex is perhaps more relevant, appertaining, as it does, to the ancient British word ischia, which meant a river abounding with fish. And there are certainly infant fish, or fry, in abundance where the two rivers converge, just above Exbridge. Where the fine old bridge spans the clean waters, these fry are enjoying the warm summer temperatures. Things can change quickly on these rivers, which take their waters from the high hills. And it's when the water is in spate that one of the most exciting events takes place on the river. The annual raft struggle used to take its competitors downstream from Tiverton, but the organisers decided there would be more thrills and spills on the faster-moving, higher stretches. Here, the narrow pilings of the small crossing at Oakford Bridge cause havoc among the rafters. At other times, the hamlet is a peaceful place with its delightful old disused mill and leat. The next stretch finds the river taking a series of major jinks and turns as it works its way through an area of harder rock. Towards the hamlet of Cove, this has resulted in the Ex taking on a deep, almost gorge-like guise as it's cut its way through the harder slate hills. And it's not the only one to have had a go at the slate. The whole area is scarred by old quarries, now disused. At Cove, the river is crossed by one of its most elegant bridges, guarded by a quaint thatched lodge. And so the Exe begins to leave the higher hills behind as it makes its way towards its first town. The river might know that something's up as it approaches Tiverton, but here it must cross its first major weirs. Tiverton was founded near the confluence of two rivers, the Exe and the Lowman, hence the original name for the place of Two Fords, Twyford. If the name has changed over the years, then so has the town. Passing over its early history, the place really came into its own just after 1100 AD, when Henry I commanded one Richard de Redvers to build a castle here. Built on an escarpment some 80 feet above the Exe, the castle was home for centuries to the two great families of the de Redvers and later the Courtenays, and the town and its people literally lived under their shadow. The place saw action during the Civil War when the Roundheads, under General Fairfax, set upon the castle, which was held by Sir Gilbert Talbot and his men. A lucky shot brought down the drawbridge in the outer fort, now long gone, and the castle was taken. One of the few fatalities occurred in this tower, where a nurse holding Sir Gilbert's baby was killed by a stray shot. But when all the troubles were at last over, it was wool and its accompanying wealth which brought the largest changes to Tiverton. And this is reflected in the grandeur of St. Peter's Church. So wealthy was local cloth merchant John Greenway, for instance, and so proud of his fleet of trading ships that he went as far as to have them modelled on the chantry which he had built off the church. By the 16th century, Tiverton was known as the chief marketplace for cloth in the entire West Country, and to this day something of the bustle of the old market town lives on, regardless of the great changes which the place has undergone. But it was a century that ended badly for the town. A plague wiped out one-tenth of the population in 1591, and a fire just about razed the place to the ground 7 years later and killed more than 50 people. The townsfolk failed to learn any lessons in fire prevention, however, because 14 years later, Tiverton was once again almost entirely destroyed by fire. And, just over a century later, the town was again burned to the ground, leaving 2,000 souls homeless. But Tiverton seems to be a place where good things always found a way of being born out of bad. For instance, the hardships caused by the Napoleonic Wars saw the closure of the new wool factory, only to see it bought up and reopened by a Leicestershire lace manufacturer, John Heathcote. His existing factory had been wrecked by Luddites, and in 1816 he transferred his business to Tiverton, along with many of his loyal craftsmen, who walked the 200 miles to join their master. The great factory still dominates the town today, and is a lasting memorial to Heathcote, who was a brilliant inventor when it came to designing machinery, which speeded up the manufacturing process, and who was, for those days, an enlightened employer. He reduced working hours, paid fair wages, and even built the West Country's first factory school. Such booming business helped to fuel grandiose schemes, such as the idea for a canal linking the Bristol and English channels. It never materialized, but the Tiverton Spur became a reality, and soon barge loads of limestone were being hauled from quarries at Cannonsley to be burned and used to fertilize the red clay farmlands. But let us return to our river and travel south to the next point of interest. Bickley is a well-known beauty spot, with its famous Trout Inn and five-arched bridge. Several books on the area claim that this was the place that inspired American songwriter Art Garfunkel to compose Bridge Over Troubled Water. Half a mile downstream and away from the main road, we're offered a deeper sense of history. Bickley Castle seems almost suspended in time. The place seems to come straight from the pages of some romantic fantasy. And romantic its history most certainly is. There's been an important dwelling here since Saxon times, and stories about the place abound. There was a runaway marriage where the elopers eventually returned to enjoy a happy ending here after the young man excelled in a battle up in the fields of Flodden. Sir George Carew, Vice Admiral of the famous Mary Rose, lived here for 10 years. The west and north fortified wings were destroyed by the parliamentarian Fairfax in the Civil War. And another more romantic twist was when one young inhabitant, one Banfield Carew, ran off to become King of the Gypsies. By now, the river has established a proper flood plain as it meanders its way towards Exeter. No one can gainsay the importance of rivers as great ecological arteries of our landscape, and it's the job of the government's environment agency to take care of our waterways. To help them do this, water bailiffs like Eddie Hayes are employed to be the agency's eyes and ears on the river.
Yes, obviously on the enforcement side, the salmon poaching, during the peak times, during the summer months, leading well up until December when the salmon spawn, there's periods of that time when we're more or less nocturnal. We work a lot of nights. You still get the person who goes out and takes the odd salmon. They take it home, they feed the family with it. But the biggest threat are these organised, like professional gangs, who come down with nets, and we have known poisons and explosives being used to take salmon. Because that, it's non-selective, it kills everything. From baby fry that was born this year, right through to the adult fish, which they're after. But it kills all the aquatic life in that stretch of river. Each warden has got his own stretch of river which he looks after. He's got all his informants, or tries to build up an informants throughout that system. They pass on the information to us. We assess it, then we pull in wardens from other areas and we set up observation points. We've got the powers. We've got the powers of arrest, search and seizure. We can seize their vehicles. We can actually get search warrants and search their homes for equipment should we detain anybody. But the police are very, very helpful. They don't mind coming out, although they're very, very stretched. And obviously the police dog in the sort of riverbank area is very, very useful for tracking and finding equipment. Everybody's more mobile now, including the poacher. The big advantage they've got, they know where they're going and when. We've got to try and get it. Most of the pollution in this sort of area would be agriculture, from farms, slurry runoff, silage effluent, very potent, and of course sewage treatment works, and ordinary domestic septic tanks, if they're not maintained and looked after properly, they leach into the river, and pollution will kill far more fish than poachers ever will. And it's like poisons, it kills everything. A bad pollution will kill everything, and it takes a long, long time for everything, all the crustaceans, all the river life, all the aquatic life, to come back as it was to sustain fish. We have conservation sites, which we do call corridor surveys on, where we go and we list all the species, look for all the bird life, possibly signs of otter, actual visual sightings of otters, which are coming back with the nice clean water quality we've got here now. And obviously the heron, the wagtail, the dipper, the kingfisher. They're all good signs that we've got a healthy river.
Rivers are important and they must be looked after, but that's not to say people can't have some fun on the water. In November, for instance, Thorvarson Weir, where we talked to Eddie, is popular among spectators who turn out to watch one of the biggest canoe races in Britain. More than 700 canoeists shoot this and many other weirs between Tiverton and Exeter. We'll be right back. and it's in the city itself that the most exciting sport can be found. Black Alawea is one of the highest on the Exe, and the rescue canoes regularly see action, as some competitors get it slightly wrong. The race ends at Exeter's famous quay, once busy with ships from the four corners of the world, now preserved and enjoyed by tourists from many countries. Thanks to the many millions of pounds worth of flood defence work which has been carried out on the Exe around the city, it's difficult to imagine the swampy, muddy banks where once ancient traders pocketed Greek coins as their primitive ships returned all the way from the Mediterranean. Whether or not the river flooded in those long gone days, we have no record, but it certainly caused appalling damage over more recent centuries. In October 1960, the Exe threw 9 million gallons a minute down its floodplain and caused damage to over 1,000 homes and businesses. Something had to be done. It's the sort of scheme the Romans would have undoubtedly approved of. They made their own changes to Exeter, changes which are still to be seen to this day. There's no evidence of any large-scale battles between the Italian invaders and the Celtic Dumnonii people who lived on what was Exeter at the time. But half a century or so later, in about 120 AD, the Romans decided to fortify the plateau above the Exe, which to this day marks the centre of the city. By the year 200, they had built a wall which enclosed nearly 100 acres, and which, remarkably for the most part, can be viewed today. So this port and river town became an important market centre for the Romans, who enjoyed the running of the place for some 300 years. After they had left, it took another three dark centuries before the town once again entered the history books. This time it was the turn of the Anglo-Saxons, who introduced the first Christian churches to the place. After the Danes had robbed and pillaged a few times, the history books eventually take us into the Norman era. And it took a siege led by William the Conqueror himself to subdue this proud Saxon city some 18 months after the battles of 1066. The good citizens were not keen on William raising their taxes, and only after 18 days of siege behind their strong walls did the burghers reach an agreement with the king, who was in fact only too keen to compromise. By 1112, the Normans were constructing a great cathedral, and just 20 years later, the building was in official use, though it took the best part of a century to fully complete. This old Norman cathedral is almost obscured today by grander rebuilding which took place in the 13th and 14th centuries. The long and intriguing history of this remarkable city would require an entire video of its own to tell, and we must return to our river to explore its final stretch leading to the sea. We begin our journey along the estuary where the flood defence scheme ends at Countess Weir. It was here in the 14th century that the Countess of Devon ordered the building of this large weir, which effectively put an end to Exeter as an actual trading port. The local merchants, understandably upset about all this, set about creating a ship canal. Their early efforts were small and unsuccessful, but works were extended to provide a longer canal in 1676. And eventually the wider, deeper waterway we see today was completed in 1825. The demise of Exeter as an actual port was good news for the village of Topsham, which happily provided a haven for the many traders wishing to do business with the great city upriver. Although there was a port here as far back as Roman times, it was a number of Dutch traders who lived here during the 18th century that provided Topsham with its heyday. Further along the eastern shore of the estuary, we come to the lovely old fishing village of Limpston, with its Italianate tower. This was built by an eccentric lady as a memorial to her husband, and must have looked pretty incongruous back in the last century, when the place was a busy fishing port, with boats travelling as far afield as Greenland to bring back a catch. Limpston was also a famous shell fishery, but now the only serious bivalve catchers belong to the local wader population. Across the now broad estuary is the historic parish of Powderham. Down this avenue of evergreen oaks we find Powderham Church, once the scene of a bloody siege during the English Civil War. On a dark night in October 1645, 200 soldiers fighting for the parliamentarians crossed the river to take Powderham Castle, but having found it far better defended than anticipated, they seized the church instead. After 3 hours of fighting, the royalists had to retire, leaving a bloody trail in the snow. But so cold was life inside the church that the troops were pulled out after a day or two. Where once patrolled hundreds of dragoons, now only fallow deer can be counted in great number. These are the grounds of Powderham Castle, home of another branch of the Courtenay family for 600 years. We follow the railway downstream to Star Cross, famed not so much for being the main harbour on the western shoreline, but for its association with the trains. The old tower, which dominates the village, is just about all that remains of Isambard Kingdom Brunel's experimental atmospheric railway, which ran along the shoreline, but which failed and was superseded by the main Great Western Line, from Paddington to Penzance. Now the building houses the local boat owners association, whose members were good enough to allow us to take our cameras to the top of the famous tower, From here, wonderful views of the estuary can be enjoyed. Trains still dash back and forth on the main line, and a ferry still crosses the estuary to Exmouth. Our next port of call is at the quaint little harbour at Cockwood. Now with restricted access caused by the railway embankment, this once busy port still exudes an air of unspoilt charm. In fact, the railways which run along both sides of the estuary have been the saving of the Exe's tidal regions, according to Jim Shapter, an Exmouth-based sailing instructor.
You go to Star Cross, all the way along there, right along the railway, thank God for Isambard K. Brunel. Because if he had not put these railway lines up each side, then this would have been like, towns all the way along, wouldn't it? The fact is that now there is a lot of misuse of the natural life of the estuary. So much misuse. They've gleaned, robbed, and removed crabs, worms, fish, the variety of crustaceans that are here. All the life, the natural life, has not been allowed to go through its normal cycle. Now, 20, 30 years ago, less than that, probably 10 years ago, I could walk down to that water's edge and turn over a stone and there'd be a little crab scurry away. Or anywhere along here I could go. Now, I went there 2 days ago, and I wanted to take my granddaughter down and show her, but it was impossible to find any crabs there. So that's why I believe it's going. People go and dig worms out there. Right, well, it's a market. Do you know some places you can get about 50 pence for a bait crab? So that's a very good opportunity to make money, isn't it, on the side. People go out on motorcycles. If you look in the background now, there's a car up against the yacht. Well, that beach is being compounded by the amount of traffic that travels across this beach.
Jim was good enough to take our camera crew out for a tour of Exmouth's harbour and the narrow estuary mouth in his boat. Inland beach of Dawlish Warren, we meet two men working on the oyster and mussel beds.
One of the biggest oyster farms in England, producing roughly about 10,000 a week for a wholesale. In bags, depending on the size of the oyster, and they're put down on these trestles nearest to the low spring water mark as we possibly can, so that they'll grow on. But I'm not going to tell you too many of my secrets.
Thank you.
As we pass through the narrow estuary mouth, we can take a good look at Exmouth itself. It became Devon's first seaside resort more than 2.5 centuries ago. Numbers 5 and 6 of the Georgian houses up on the hill, known as the Beacon, are renowned for the two ladies who once lived there. Both had famous husbands. One was Lady Byron and the other Lady Nelson. Lastly, our journey takes us to the lonely peninsula that guards the estuary. Dawlish Warren is so named because of the great rabbit warren which had its home in the dunes over many centuries. This extraordinary geographical feature has been caused by fine sands being washed along the coast over many thousands of years to be deposited where the quieter waters of the estuary meet the sea. A trip to the Warren must begin at the seaside resort, but one can quickly leave behind the world of tourism to enjoy the quietness of the dunes. A walk to the inland shore can be rewarded by a visit to the Hyde, from where excellent views of the river's rich bird life can be enjoyed. And so we reach the end of our river's journey. The English Channel coast curves away east and west, and the fine silts and sands, some perhaps from as far away as Exmoor's high hills, are deposited here at Pole Sands, where lonely cormorants and other birds stretch their wings in the salty breeze.
Please like, share, and subscribe to The Good, The Bad, and The Ugly Show.
Because there's no room left.